I never even thought about the horizon the eye level thing was a big deal. I mean, I never thought about it, but from the first day in formation training, you know, you're looking at the other airplane and your instructor goes, if he's above the horizon, you're below him. If he's below the horizon, you're above him. If he's on the horizon, you're level. 100% fact all the time.
Hi, folks. So that was Mike just speaking, and Mike is a retired F-16 fighter pilot, and that was part of an interview that he did with Ben from Taboo Conspiracy and Bob from Globusters, probably over a year ago now. I've been wanting to make a video to follow that up for quite a while, just got around to it, so I'm going to be inputting some of the numbers that Mike talked about into AutoCAD, see how they work out on a globe Earth, so I hope you enjoy.
You know, I never considered even about flat Earth, right? I mean, it was just a plain fact for us was if he is on the horizon, then you are level with him. If he is above the horizon, then you've got the horizon down there. That's level. He's above you if he's above the horizon. And if he's below, it's below. I mean, it's that simple, but I never even really considered that. It's not something I'd come across in any of the stuff that I'd watch and had been watching, but you get to thinking about it and go, well, geez, yeah, if you go up above a ball, the horizon is going to be down there. If you go up above a big vast flat Earth, then it's going to stay at eye level because of perspective. So if I'm looking out there and I see this guy and I've got a TD box, a target designation box comes up in the HUD, what I'm locked on, I can pull my nose to him and look out there and try to get my eyeballs on him. So, because at 20 miles, you're not seeing the guy yet. You know, you're not going to see him till probably, depending on the conditions, I don't even remember really, but probably 12 miles at the most, you're not seeing a guy out there at 20 miles.
Okay, so in AutoCAD, I've drawn a circle with a radius of 3,959. If I zoom in, right to the top, you'll see that I've drawn a blue band around the entire circumference of this circle, and that band has an offset of 10,000 feet. So the top of that blue band is 10,000 feet. And if I zoom right in, you'll see I've drawn an F-16 with its nose dead on 10,000 feet. From the nose of the F-16, there's this dotted line that extends out here, which I'm going to select. That is the line to the horizon as seen from that F-16. And that is all the way over here, this point here, which if I hover on top of it, tells me is 122.4737 miles. Incidentally, the angle down from horizontal to the horizon is 1.8 degrees. So that's how far the pilot would have to dip his head down to look dead at the horizon. Okay, so Mike said that it's unlikely you're going to see an enemy aircraft beyond 12 miles. So I've drawn a distance of 12 miles from the first F-16, which is here, and I've placed another one dead on the horizon. Now, if you remember what Mike said, that anything above the horizon is above you, anything below the horizon is below you, anything on the horizon is at the same level as you. Okay, so this is on the horizon, but it's definitely not at the same level as the other F-16. In fact, it is at 7,920 feet, not 10,000 feet. So there's a mismatch there straight away. Okay, let's carry on, and Mike's going to explain about the radar systems within the F-16s and how they also debunk the globe.
Well, this radar on the Viper is it's got a huge scan volume, right? Plus or minus 60 of the nose left and right, and 4 bars up and down. They call it plus or minus 64 bar or plus or minus 32 bar, whatever, right? So these 4 bars are the scanning bars, like, and I'm pretty sure, but I would have to, this is 20, even like my training in F-16s was over 30 years ago. So take some of this with a grain of salt, but I'm pretty sure that like your radar, you can see my fingers, right? Mm-hmm. Your radar is like a flashlight beam, right?
Yes.
It radiates out.
It's slightly divergent.
I guess in a cone or it really in Doppler radars, it's more like a square maybe. But at any rate, it's like this. And I think this is 30 degrees, mm-hmm. right? So four bar would be, it starts up here, 60 degrees to the left, scans over, 60 degrees to the right, drops down one bar, which would be 30 degrees, right? Scans back, so the bottom is basically at your nose, it's level if you got the L strobe in the notch in the center. It scans back. That's so you've got the upper 60 degrees covered, right? To mm-hmm. twice at 30 degrees. Then it drops down another 30, scans back, all the way back over to right 60. Then it drops down again, scans back to drop that other 60 degrees. So I'm pretty sure it's 120 degrees this way and 120 degrees this way. This way, I'm not positive about, but I'm almost positive. Okay, so that's a huge search volume, right? That's, mm-hmm. if you go the rate, and there's ranges that you set in the radar. You can set it at 10, you can set it at 20, you can set it at 40, you can set it at 80. It even goes out farther than that. I think 120. But it may have been one CED. I don't recall exactly, right? Mm-hmm. But we typically ran it out at 40 miles because, being careful what I say, a fighter-sized target is probably not going to show up beyond the 40-mile range, okay? Just suffice it to say that.
We are here. We are pointing that way, and this is a top-down display. The range scale on the right here, 0, 10, 20, 30, 40 nautical miles controlled by this range here. Currently 40 miles, could be 80, could be 20. We can also increase the scale by going up like that and down like that. Next is our azimuth display, currently set to 60 A6. That means it will scan 60 degrees to the right of us, 60 degrees to the left of us. We can have 30 left, 30 right. The limits shown by this line here and here, or 10 either way. We can then move the acquisition cursor around, and the limits of what the radar will display will be shown between these lines here. These guys, as you'll see, we will lose contact with them, and the white bricks will disappear because they're no longer in our scan azimuth. Speed up, and they're gone. Repopulate, let's say A30 I like to use generally, and you'll see that these targets will start to repopulate. In terms of our elevation of scan, it's measured in bars. Each bar is about 6 or 7 degrees, I think. Currently 4 bars, so there's about 20 something degrees of total elevation coverage. You can change that to 1 bar, 2 bars, 4 bars. I tend to leave it at 4 bars for general purpose, but if you want to speed up the scan refresh rate, you can reduce the number of bars, but just beware that you also reduce the elevation of coverage of your radar by doing that.
So we pretty much ran, if you're just fully scanning, not really going to fight, you're running plus or minus 64 bar, both you and your wingman and the other element if you've got a four ship, right? Everybody's around that, just keeping it wide open. So typically our engagements, you would have the red, your adversary, we call them red air, and we're blue air. We're the good guys, they're the bad guys. They would split off and they would go to a point at least 40 miles away downrange from you. This is all in protected airspace, right? You would have blocks, altitude blocks. For blue air is 0s to 4s, red air is 5 to 9s, right? That means like from 10,000 to 14,000 feet is my airspace. It skips 1,000 feet and goes 5 to 9. So the blue or red air is in 5 to 9, 15 to 19. And then it would skip another 1,000 feet. I've got a block up at 20 to 24 and so on. I got a block at 30 to 34 if I've got the airspace up there. Okay, does that make sense?
Absolutely.
So everything's all sorted out so that when we come at each other at 12 to 1,500 miles an hour, then until you have complete SA on where everybody is, you don't leave your block. You stay in your block until you, if you go into a bad guy block, you got to know where everybody is, right? Mm-hmm. So whether you're fighting 2v2 or 2v4 or 4v4 or whatever, kind of need to keep track of where everybody is. And that's the hard part. Air is hard. Anyway, So the radar, you get this 40-mile set, right? Everybody has a search responsibility. I'll just say that it's we're in a 2v4, okay? Two of me versus four of them, right? Mm-hmm. We're separated by 40 miles. We're going to push, which means we're going to fights on. They come in whatever formation they're going to come in, and we're going to do our tactics to defeat what their formation is. Anyway, so because of this plus or minus 64 bar takes a really long time and we're coming at each other so fast, you want to reduce your scope's coverage down so that it covers it faster so you can find them quicker, right? Does that make sense?
Generally speaking, it is not a good idea to max your radar out. It's not a good idea, generally speaking, to have 60 degrees left, 60 degrees right, and four bars, because the refresh rate is very slow. Look how long it takes this azimuth carrot to go left and right, and look how long it takes this to go up and down. It makes very poor radar performance. Best thing, I think, is to set at A3, and then if you need a very fast track, then you can bring the bars down if you want. That's how I suggest using the radar on the F-16.
So what we would typically do is, I got my wingman line abreast a mile away from me, right? He's over there, I'm over here. We split the scope down the middle, so I got plus or minus 30 here, and I'm searching, say, surface to 20,000 feet. Yeah, that works better. I'm probably going to leave it in four bar if it's just a two ship. If it's a four ship, then we can split it into two bar and we can search quadrants of the sky, right? So right. We divide the sky up into quadrants and move the radar to where it makes sense. Okay, here's where the radar mechanics works. Because I want to search high, right? I'm just doing two bar up high. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to search from, say we're at the bottom of our block, 10,000 feet. I'm going to search 10,000 feet and above, and I want my wingman to search 10,000 feet and below, right? So you do this knob on the throttle. It's called the L strobe, elevation, whatever, strobe. You can roll the radar search volume up so that there's a number on the cursor, right? The bottom number is the lowest bit. So if I'm searching 10,000 and above, I'm at 10,000 feet, then the bottom number on the cursor is going to say 10,000. Now it's searching up here, right? Mm-hmm. So I got 10,000 and above. So I don't expect to see anybody out there at 40 miles below 10,000 feet. What is that telling you now? I'm at 10,000 feet. I got the lowest part of my radar looking above 10,000 feet at 40 miles, but mm-hmm. because I just ran my cursor out there and I set it there. What happened to the curvature between me and 40 miles? I would really be searching higher than that, right? If I set the cursor, the bottom of my cursor, basically level with the nose of my airplane, can you see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
I there and I run that all the way out to where to 40 miles, that the numbers change because the search volume gets bigger, but just the upper number is going to change because I've got this bottom set, right?
Right.
So the because it's, you know, 60 degrees higher, you know, so the volume is higher out there, but that bottom number doesn't change. I roll it all the way out to 40 miles. It ought to be this
dropping
bottom
down.
Ought to be dropping.
That's right.
Higher.
Because otherwise, if it didn't, then the problem is going to be that somebody's going to literally slip in under your radar.
That's
literally.
Exactly right.
That but doesn't happen.
That doesn't happen.
Okay, so we've got the same diagram. And if I zoom in, we've got the F-16 at 10,000 feet again. The red line extending out here is the bottom of the radar detection zone. So that's also at 10,000 feet, and that extends horizontally to 40 miles. Okay, so we're all the way to here. And obviously it's detecting 10,000 feet and everything within 30 degrees upwards as well. So anything flying in this zone here should be detected. So again, if we zoom in, I've drawn another F-16 here at 10,000 feet. However, the bottom of the detection zone from the other F-16 is here, and that measurement happens to be 1,066 feet. So he would not be detected by the radar of the other F-16. This guy would not be detected. He'd be 1,066 feet lower than the bottom of the detection pattern, even though he is flying at 10,000 feet. The horizon, from the perspective of the other F-16, is here. And that is 1.24 miles below the bottom of the detection pattern, the detection zone. So it's way out. Okay, so let's move closer and see how far this F-16 can get to this F-16 before he gets detected by the radar. Well, again, he's still at 10,000 feet here, and he's still below the bottom of the detection zone here, and that is 4.4 miles. I actually think he could go a little bit closer. The tail isn't quite touching the bottom of the zone yet, so he could actually go in, I don't know, maybe around here somewhere. So he could probably get in an extra, half a mile or so. And what makes this even crazier is that he is way above the horizon. So at 4.4 miles, he's easily within visual range of this F-16. But he's way above the horizon, yet not being detected by the lowest part of the radar. I mean, it's a double debunking there. And in anticipation of the argument of refraction that's likely to come back, I would say that refraction is a ever-changing, dynamic phenomenon that cannot be accurately relied upon for radar operations. This electronic warfare fundamentals document that I found online, easily downloadable if you want to find it, it goes into a section, and this is talking all about refraction. So I'm going to go through this because some of it's quite interesting. So as altitude increases, the barometric pressure and water vapor content decrease rapidly. At the same time, the absolute temperature decreases slowly based on the standard lapse rate. Using equation that, it can be seen that the refractivity of the atmosphere decreases with increasing altitude. This decrease in refractivity means that the velocity of RF waves increases with altitude. The result is a downward bending or refraction of RF waves as depicted in figure 210, which is this one. Where did we get to? RF wave refraction primarily affects ground-based radar systems at low antenna elevation angles. Okay, so it's mainly for ground-based radar systems, especially at or near the horizon. For most radar applications, refraction is not a factor at elevations above 5 degrees. The term anomalous or non-standard propagation is used to describe atmospheric conditions that extend the propagation of RF waves and increase radar range. The most common anomalous propagation phenomena is called superrefraction or ducting. So, a super refracting duct is formed when the refractivity of the atmosphere rapidly decreases with altitude. Based on equation that, this occurs when the temperature increases with altitude and or the water vapor content decreases with altitude. An increase in temperature with altitude is called a temperature inversion. To produce a duct, the temperature inversion must be very pronounced. So, it's saying that these have to be very specific conditions for these ducts to occur. A super refracting duct acts like a waveguide which traps the RF wave. This channels the radar signal and reduces attenuation. In order for an RF wave to propagate within a duct, the angle of the radar signal in relation to the duct should be less than 1 degree. Very specific. The RF waves trapped by the duct take advantage of the decrease in refractivity and travel much further than normal. This can greatly extend the range of a radar system. Now, this picture here that they've drawn, this is showing the radar on the ship, and it looks like that the signal is going up and down, up and down, up and down, up and down. What I find intriguing about this is that how the heck can the elevation of anything within this range be known if the pattern is going up and down like this? It's just nonsensical to me. Anyway, reading on. The extension of radar range inside a duct can result in a reduction of radar coverage outside the duct. The area of reduced radar coverage because of ducting is called a radar hole. Due to radar holes, the extended radar range caused by ducting may result in a decrease in radar coverage along other paths of propagation. These holes can seriously degrade the effectiveness of early warning radar systems. For example, a radar system is taking advantage of a duct formed at the surface to extend low-altitude radar range. Airborne targets flying just above the duct would normally be detected, but because of ducting, these targets may be missed. Water vapor content is a significant factor in producing ducts. Consequently, most ducts are formed over water and in warm climates. Any atmospheric phenomenon that results in a pronounced increase in temperature and/or a decrease in water vapor content as altitude increases can generate a super-refracting duct, of which there are three types. A super-refracting duct, which is formed just above the surface of the Earth, is referred to as a surface duct. A surface duct formed just above the surface of the ocean is called an evaporation duct. A duct which is formed well above the surface of the Earth is known as an elevated duct. Surface ducts form over land are usually a result of the nighttime radiation of heat from the Earth. Again, this is time dependent. Duct formation is especially prevalent during the summer months when the ground is moist. As the Earth loses heat, a temperature inversion is created at the surface, coupled with a sharp decrease in the moisture content. These conditions are favourable to the formation of a surface duct. A super-refracting duct can also be produced by the diverging downdraft under a thunderstorm. Again, another very specific condition. The cool air that is dispersed creates a local temperature inversion while the water vapour content decreases due to rain. Surface ducts formed in conjunction with thunderstorms are difficult to predict and normally persist for a short period of time. A super-refracting duct that lies just above the surface of the ocean is a result of evaporated water, thus the term evaporation duct. The air in contact with the ocean is saturated with water vapour, while the air several feet above the ocean contains a much lower level. This rapid decrease in water vapour pressure with an increase in altitude creates an evaporation duct. An evaporation duct exists over the ocean almost all the time. So you can see further than you should be able to over the ocean all the time. The height of this duct varies from 20 to 100 feet based on the season, time of day, and wind speed. One positive aspect of an evaporation duct is the extended range available to a shipborne radar system with a properly aligned antenna. This extended range coverage against surface ships and low altitude aircraft is a definite advantage of ducted propagation. An elevated duct is generally formed by a temperature inversion in the upper atmosphere. To take maximum advantage of the increased radar range inside an elevated duct, both the radar and the target should be inside the elevated duct. In addition, radar systems operating below an elevated duct may also experience enhanced range performance. And then this number four here sums it all up, I think. So the presence of surface ducts and elevated ducts, especially over land, are extremely difficult to predict and may persist for very short periods of time. The atmospheric conditions favourable to duct formation are difficult to predict using conventional weather forecasting techniques. And there you have it. There's no way that they can accurately rely upon super refracting ducts for radar operations.
From thousands of hours of experience, that the horizon is your level. I mean, yes, it's an eye level, it's your level. Anything above it is above you. Anything below it is below you. I mean, that's fact.